All right, the last part of chapter 6 is dealing with fermentation. And fermentation is the kind of thing that our cells need if no oxygen is available. Fermentation is something that also gives us a certain amount of energy, but it's not really very good. It's an emergency resource, if you will. What we just talked about was how to extract energy from glucose in really the most efficient way possible. But we can also go without oxygen for short periods of time. And if we need to do this, then our cells can actually produce some ATP under anaerobic conditions. Now, aerobic, you remember, that was with oxygen. Therefore, anaerobic is in the absence of oxygen. And this is what we call fermentation. Fermentation is the process by which we extract energy from food without oxygen. Why do we need this? You need this whenever the energy need or the energy use outpaces your ability to breathe. And think about this for a minute. There are a variety of muscle cells that are relatively far in terms of your circulatory system from the lungs, but that's where the oxygen comes from. In addition, not every cell has a big open pipeline to the lungs, big veins and arteries, right? The arteries are what's going to deliver the oxygen-rich blood, and some of those get very small, very narrow capillaries, and then they stop entirely, and all this oxygen just sort of has to filter through from cell to cell to cell. And that can take a while. And so if you imagine you're doing some exercise, let's say that you have a bar with some weights on it and you're doing some curls in the gym and you're doing your lifting, then of course you're breathing, so there's oxygen coming into your body. But your exercise, as you keep doing this, is going to start depleting your muscle cells of oxygen. And when your muscle cells are completely depleted with lack of oxygen, then you don't want them to just die. That would be a bad side effect of exercising. So obviously that doesn't happen. So the question is, what actually does happen? Well, those cells can switch to fermentation. And they switch to fermentation at the point where your exercise starts to feel just a little strenuous. And so if you're in the gym and you're doing your exercise and you get to that point where you go, oh, I can feel it now, that's the point when your muscles are starting to do something a little bit differently. Now, if you normally look at what muscle cells do, is they, of course, they will break down the glucose and they will use oxygen and so on. But they can also switch. And so they're able to switch into an entirely different pathway, metabolic pathway. So rather than using glycolysis and citric acid cycle and the electron transport chain, they can do something very different. Normally, your cells come endowed with a certain amount of energy. In fact, each of your cells, probably as you're sitting there right now, has enough ATP for a short sprint, maybe about 5 seconds. In addition, there is an emergency reserve with creatine phosphate, that little phosphate again. So you have some phosphate from ATP, and you have about 10 seconds more from creatine phosphate. Add that up. That's 15 seconds. And from an evolutionary perspective, you may say that these 15 seconds are basically what it might take for you to real quick get away from a predator. If you watch Animal Planet and you look at animal chases, you will find that these animal chases where a predator is chasing after a prey, they don't ever take more than 15 seconds. Because if after 15 seconds the rabbit hasn't gotten away, it's pretty much done for. Because that's all the energy they have. That's why the element of surprise works so well when you're trying to catch something. Because then you can be just a little bit faster out of the gate than your prey item. Now, of course, if this happened to us and we try to get away, let's say, from a bear, you can imagine 15 seconds is a matter of life and death. Now, when a bear chases after a bunch of people, you know that you don't have to be the fastest. You just have to be the second slowest, and that'll do it. So 15 seconds is actually a long time. Now, if you need something beyond that, that's when you force yourselves to change. There is a little bit more in some situations, but not much. And so let's take a look at what fermentation actually does. First of all, because there is no oxygen, it means you cannot use the electron transport chain. That whole thing only works if electrons are attracted by oxygen. If that one doesn't work, there's no point in making all these electrons available in the citric acid cycle. So all these NADH and FADH2 carriers, they're not going to be useful because they're only useful when you have the electron transport chain at the end. So fermentation by necessity is only modified glycolysis. Modified glycolysis means that glycolysis happens and then the process changes. So the first part is actually the same. Glycolysis produces pyruvic acid and NADH the way it normally would. So glucose is oxidized, the NAD plus is reduced, and that's what we've seen before. But now is the difference. Instead of taking the electrons to the electron transport chain, the NADH actually passes them to the pyruvic acid. NADH becomes oxidized because it loses electrons. Pyruvic acid becomes reduced because it gains them. So what you've done now is you've recycled the NAD+. The NAD+ can go back to the beginning of glycolysis and do it over. And of course that means you can very quickly keep glycolysis going. And that product that you produce when pyruvic acid is reduced is called lactic acid. And lactic acid is the thing that makes your muscles ache. That's what builds up during your muscles as you exercise, and that is actually what starts to impede your muscle movement. When I said you start to feel your muscles as you exercise, that's because you're just starting to get a little bit more friction in your muscles, literally, because there is now a lactic acid buildup. And that buildup lingers. Even when you're done exercising, you end up with a muscle ache, and it takes a couple of days for your body to break that down again. And here's what that looks like. This is called lactic acid fermentation. That's what you see in our version of fermentation. So here you have this first part up to here. That's basically what glycolysis was before. We have cut out some things. We have not included an energy investment phase in here. So basically, this is what you get out. That's your net ATP gain. 2 ATP. Net ATP. Normally, the pyruvic acid would then go on into the citric acid cycle, but here we're doing something different. So this second part here, that's the difference. In the second part is where we dump these electrons onto the pyruvic acid, and that creates lactic acid. Now notice, the way this is shown here, pyruvic acid is a 3-carbon molecule, and so is lactic acid. So there is no difference in the way it's written here. The difference is only in how many hydrogens and how many electrons lactic acid has versus how many pyruvic acid has. So it's a very subtle difference between these two molecules. But obviously, it's a key difference because this stuff accumulates and it takes a while to break it down. This would ordinarily very quickly disappear in the citric acid cycle. The outcome is that you are left with NAD+, which can then move back to the beginning and start this process over. And so the NAD+ almost acts a little bit like an enzyme. It temporarily takes something and moves it from A to B, and it comes right back. It's not being used up, it's just being recycled. and round it goes. In microorganisms, there is a slightly different pathway. It's an alternative energy pathway in some organisms. And in yeast cells, we've been able to study this process very well. In fact, in yeast cells, it breaks down the pyruvic acid to carbon dioxide and ethanol, ethyl alcohol. Now, yeast, of course, is something we know quite well from various industrial applications. This process is called alcoholic fermentation for obvious reasons. And we use it, or a variation of it, in baking, in winemaking, brewing, and various kinds of other things. So if you think about baking, you sometimes want to have the bread rise, right? Well, the rising is because there's carbon dioxide in it. Baker's yeast is not a yeast that produces a huge amount of alcohol, because we don't want the alcohol in baking. But even if you did have a little bit of alcohol in there, it would be changed into something non-alcoholic by the baking process. So the main thing you're after with baker's yeast is the carbon dioxide to make it fluffy. Winemaking and brewing. Well, in brewing, you also want a lot of carbon dioxide, and you do want a certain amount of ethyl alcohol. And in winemaking, you don't really want the bubbles, except for champagne. So you want very little carbon dioxide, but you do want the alcohol. And there's various things you can do at home, of course. Some of you may be involved in winemaking or brewing. But we also have industrial processes to make alcohol and so on. Now, if you look at alcoholic fermentation, you will once again realize that the first part is the same. This is standard glycolysis, so here you have your net 2-ATP, and you again produce pyruvic acid. Here's where the difference begins. The chemicals in the yeast, the enzymes available in the yeast, are slightly different from what we have. And so instead of moving this on into lactic acid, they actually snip off some of these, and carbon dioxide is released. It's a very subtle variation, and it's only something because we are different organisms than yeast. And the outcome is, well, the NAD plus still gets recycled, so that's the same, but we end up with ethyl alcohol. And ethyl alcohol is basically this with an OH group at the end. So it's a very simple molecule, and of course that's what you'll find in those beverages and so on. Now, the last part of this is again one of those big picture kind of things, which is what we started this chapter with. When you look at our energy cycle and you realize that it has a complete dependence on oxygen for things to work out for large-bodied organisms like us, then you have to say to yourself, clearly this whole process would not be possible without oxygen. I mean, that's the main driver of the system in the electron transport chain. And so let's take a look at oxygen in the atmosphere for a minute. When you look at really old rocks, something that's down here in this blue area, you find out that there was no oxidation. So no rust, no copper oxides, no oxides of any kind. The oldest rocks do not have any oxides on them. If you expose any rock to oxygen, within a very short period of time, oxides will form. Oxygen is a very powerful electron magnet, like I said, and so oxidation will occur. Which means, if you don't find any oxides, there was no oxygen that these rocks were exposed to. So no oxidation. That means oxygen was absent in the early atmosphere. And then as you go through the rocks and you get to about this time here, about 2.7 billion years ago, then you realize atmospheric oxygen first appears in the fossil record. So when geologists crack open some of those rocks or look in the area where those rocks exist, then you start to see oxides. And there are various ways by which you determine the age of rocks. We'll get to that a little bit later. Now, once you have oxygen, that doesn't mean that you have it at the level needed for us. Remember at the beginning, I told you we basically need 4% oxygen. That's what we need to pick up, and that's what we need for our respiratory processes. You start out with a little bit of oxygen. And at some point, about 2.2 billion years ago, you realize that atmospheric oxygen reaches 10% of modern level. So that would be about 2.1%. Because right now, it's 21%. And so then, at this level, that's when you start to see the first large-celled organism, the first complex kinds of cells. Cells that we would recognize as modern eukaryotic cells. So this process took a while. Now we know where oxygen came from. Oxygen came from plants. Initially, small plant-like cells, microbes that could photosynthesize, and they started to produce oxygen. When you form a planet, and it doesn't have an atmosphere, and it's basically a bunch of molten rock that you throw together, there is no oxygen. You're not going to find oxygen in a volcano with the liquid magma inside of it. You're not going to find any oxygen because it burns up. You find carbon dioxide, but no oxygen. So you needed something to turn the carbon dioxide into liberate the oxygen. Or you needed something to liberate oxygen. Maybe water, maybe carbon dioxide. And this is the key connection between chapters 6 and 7. Without chapter 7, photosynthesis, you wouldn't have chapter 6.